Good morning, and welcome to the Wednesday Word. We just clicked on 10 o'clock, and what was very interesting was I was sitting here waiting for my Zoom to open up for me, and it was just kind of hanging out, and I just actually was sitting here, and my wife, Danielle, had sent me a couple of things to look at on Amazon, because, you know, we like Amazon. Amazon's fun, and all of a sudden, I'm like, man, you know, it's 9:59, I'm getting ready to get going. So I start shutting everything else down, start bringing my mind into God. And then I'm sitting, I was like, all right, 10 o'clock. Okay, so let's get going here. It's all of a sudden I looked up at my computer and it's nothing going on. And then Zoom pops up and it's loading right at 10 o'clock. It's just decides to turn on at 10 o'clock. Isn't it interesting how it was right after I said, God, help me right now, please. Help me move forward, help me create something. You know, because one of the things that we tend to do is we tend to sit in our own world sometimes. We sit in our own world and you know, it's easy to struggle from time to time. It's easy to sit back and be stuck in the mud. My name is Steve Krivda, and welcome to the Wednesday Word. And I'm excited for you to be here. You know, I was excuse me. I was looking at, you know, what am I going to talk about today? And when I woke up last night, I had a conversation with a client, and we got heavy into God and heavy into what the evil one loves to do. He loves to beat up on us every once in a while when we're not paying attention. And, you know, my client was being beat up on, being picked on by the bully. And I'm like, I said, just so you know, because of this conversation here, there's a good chance the evil one's going to come after me today. And I said, I just need to make sure I'm aware of it. Now, here's a funny thing. For the most part in our lives, being aware of what's happening and being aware of what we think is going to come works. However, the evil one knows that we're aware. He knows. He waits for the moment for when you're not paying attention, for when you're either tired, maybe something set you off or something kind of threw you for a loop for just a few moments. And then he jumps and pounces. He's kind of like, I have a kitty cat. I saw a kitty cat. She's probably, I think she's 4 or 5 now. And, she's just dainty, little tiny kitty cat. And she sits back and waits for these little, she's kind of a booger, if you know kitty cats. She gets birds and rats and bunnies and all that kind of stuff. Yeah, I know, it bothers me too. And I watch her sometimes as she's out here, and they'll notice that she's sitting there, and then she'll just wait and sit there. And she'll sit there for ages waiting for the right time to pounce. It's always when the animal that she's stalking gets comfortable. And then boom, she's got this animal. Then she brings it to us as a gift. Excuse me, I know it's kind of gross. Anyways, so excuse me for 1 second, I need to clear my throat. So as I sit here and I think about the struggles, and you know, the devil waited last night for Danielle and the boys to come home. The dog came running in. Everybody came into my office at one time. It was chaos. And when I wasn't paying attention, I get a message from somebody about something that I was waiting to come to fruition. And it was not exactly what was planned on. So it threw me for a loop just for about 10 minutes. And then I realized, oh my goodness, way to go, man. You got me. Way to go. And I have to take a step back and when we look at where we sit, it's like, well, what are we doing, man? You know, we wake up each day, and sometimes we wake up in a great mood and something can throw you off kilter just like that. Or sometimes you're in a kind of in the doldrums, and then something just miraculously, no pun intended, will come up and will kind of be there for us. But the real question comes down into is, what are we believing? What are we believing? Isaiah 53, I'm going to read from the New Living Translation, the NLT version. It's very interesting. It's a long, it's not a long chapter, excuse me. It's actually quite a short chapter. But the verses are kind of extensive. And, you know, it's talking about when they brought Christ out of They brought him out after being, it's hard for me to even sit here and think about this when I visualize the whole thing. They brought him out of captivity. Who has believed our message? It starts off with, to whom has the Lord revealed his powerful arm? My servant grew up in the Lord's presence like a tender green shoot, like a root in the dry ground. There was nothing beautiful or majestic about his appearance. Nothing attracted us to him. And what's interesting when we start thinking about this, the story here is like, well, where are we suffering? Where are we creating this world of feeling alone? Because that's what it really comes down to. Fear is another derivative, in my opinion, of loneliness, where we're doing it by ourselves. Because if we knew God was on our shoulder, in our body, in our hearts, in our minds, and was constantly guiding us, directing us, protecting us from everything possible, wouldn't we be, well, courageous, more courageous? However, when we look at Christ, you know, I love the pictures that we have drawn of him. If you really look at him, he was just this tattered dude. He wore this old tattered robe, right? He had a big old long beard that he really kind of just, you know, was just huge. He had long hair and he wore sandals. It's not like he was a Pharisee that walked around with jewels and everything and a crown. The only crown he got to wear was a crown of thorns. And because of who he was, the people in charge, now I want you to start putting yourself in this place, excuse me. And if you think about it for a second, how many people in your life right now may or may not be supporting what you're doing or where you are in your life? You know, not everybody's always on board and where we are, but because Christ was pulling, excuse me, because Christ was pulling the attention off of these Pharisees and onto himself, not on purpose. He wasn't like, hey, everybody, look at me. He was more of, what can I do for you? So because of that, he was despised and rejected. You see, I can ask you right now, if you're on this call right now, there's a good chance you have a servant heart. You love to give. He was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows, acquainted with deepest grief. We turned our backs on him and looked the other way. He was despised and we didn't even care. Yet this is where it gets, oh man, I'm going to read a quote from you at the end of this that I heard last night in my church board meeting that blew me away when I really thought about it. I think I'm going to get something made and put in my office. Yet it was our weakness he carried, our weaknesses, plural, he carried. It was our sorrows that weighed him down. And we thought his troubles were a punishment from God, a punishment for his own sins. But he was pierced for our rebellion, crushed for our sins. He was beaten so we could be whole. He was whipped so we could be healed. All of us like sheep, we strayed away. We have left God's path to follow our own. Yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all. My goodness gracious. When I think of myself and my insecurities and fears and doubts, and I start beating on myself, because aren't we good at that? Aren't we great at saying how no good we are? Aren't we great at saying how invaluable we are? Aren't we great at just pointing out our own inefficiencies? Aren't we awesome at that? But we don't have to worry about it, man. He was oppressed and treated harshly, yet he never said a word. Oh my gosh. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter. And as a sheep and silent before the shearers, he did not open his mouth. Unjustly condemned, he was led away. How many times have you been falsely accused of something and it just was what it was? There was no turning back. There was no arguing. There was no putting up a fight. It just was. Whomever said what they said. You're this, you're that, you've done this, you've done that. It doesn't matter what the truth is, it's all the perception. If we look back in Christ's time, it wasn't about the truth is what the Pharisees were putting out there into the public. It wasn't about truth. It was about perception. It was about what they saw. It was about, you don't look at me. I'm the Pharisee. I am the King of Kings. I rule the land. Who is this servant person, this dirty person in a robe and sandals? Why do you follow him and not me? How many times have you been falsely accused? It was a Pharisee's perception of what Christ was. it was them. It was their perception. It was their perception of you're taking from me. In all reality, he was giving everything. He was oppressed and treated harshly, yet he never said a word. He was like a lamb to the slaughter, led like a lamb to the slaughter, as a sheep is a silent before the shearers. He did not open his mouth. Unjustly condemned, he was led away. No one cared that he died without descendants, that his life was cut short in midstream, but he was struck down for the rebellion of my people. Tell me if this rings true for you. He had done no wrong. Being falsely accused is painful because it hits you right in the heart. It's like, I didn't do anything. I didn't do what they're saying that I did in order to create that pain that they have in their heart right now, that anger that they have towards me. On a side note here, I don't believe that there is. I believe anger is an immediate response. I believe we have two main emotions, and that's joy, which creates happiness and excitement and all that kind of fun stuff. And then we have sorrow or sadness. And sorrow or sadness breeds anger and fear. So you can't be angry without getting your feelings hurt, right? Just can't all of a sudden be like, oh, I'm just mad. You were disrespected or your feelings hurt or anything like that. It's a pain. We tend to turn into anger. He was struck down for the rebellion of my people. Come on. He had done no wrong and he had never deceived anyone. But he was buried like a criminal. He was put in a rich man's grave. But it was the Lord's good plan to crush him and cause him grief. Yet when his life is made an offering for sin, he will have many descendants. See, when we get hurt by someone's words or actions towards us, for most people, it causes us to shut down, pull away. Imagine if you just kept moving. Who could you impact? Who could you inspire? Who could follow you? Who could see you? Who could, there's a, I don't remember where it is, but it's, they will know you by his love. They will know him by your love. Do they know him by your love? It goes on in verse 11. When he sees all that is accomplished by his anguish, he will be satisfied. And because of his experience, my righteous servant will make it possible to many to be counted righteous. For he will bear all sins. I will give him the honor of a victorious soldier because he exposed himself to death. He counted among the rebels. He was counted among the rebels. He bore the sins of many and interceded for rebels. You see, when we sit back and we're in our moment, like yesterday when the devil, he was a bad guy, man. He jumped in on me when I wasn't paying attention. He got me again this morning. He doesn't want us to talk great things. He doesn't want us to create hope. He may not feed your mind with insecurities, fears, and doubts. He may come after somebody you know that may speak insecurity, fear, and doubt in your life. He may attack you where he needs to attack you, meaning it could be lack of sleep. It could be setting you up for an expectation that might be slightly out of grip at this point in time. He's great at what he does. He's the master of deception. But then we turn to the Lord. I asked God this morning, straight up, I could use some help today. And then he gave me Isaiah 53, which I heard last night in our board meeting, but I didn't hear it quite as loud as I did this morning. See, the meaning was different. Last night it meant one thing. This morning it meant something different. When we pull back for a minute, we create the meaning in our lives according to our belief system. And if you believe that God has your back for everything you've ever done and everything you will do, then you know that you have something to look forward to, and that's called everlasting life at the right hand of God. I'm going to read something and then we'll close out in prayer. And I'm going to read it twice because it's so powerful. Christ was treated as we were deserved to be treated. So we are to be treated as he was to be treated. Christ took everything for us so we could be treated like him. Righteous in heaven. So now that I've said that, I'll read it one more time. Christ was treated as we were deserved to be treated, so we are to be treated as he was to be treated, as the Son of God. Dearest Father in heaven, thank you so much for this day, Lord. Thank you for blessing us with this amazing message. There are people out there suffering in anguish and where they are, Lord. Intercede for them. Let them know that you are there as their attorney to represent them to your Father, God. Help us walk in your name, hear your word, Lord. Let us feel you in our hearts. Let us decipher those words in our minds. Help us move forward in your holy name. Keep us safe and be with those we said we pray for. In Jesus' name, amen. Man, I hope you have an absolutely blessed day. I hope you grab something great from today. And God bless you. And I will, God willing, no matter what, somehow or another, I'll see you in about a week. Love y'all. Bye-bye.